Eve is on vacation still, and we're hoping that you get a little rest and relaxation, and we're happy to have each of you here who join us for worship on Sunday morning, and also who join us via a video. And just a reminder that we are on television on Monday evening on the local cable at 7 o'clock, and on Tuesday morning at 9. So you can tune in and see the service, or if you missed, you can do that too. I got a little story to tell you in a moment, but we are happy this morning to have with us our young people who are going to the National ELCA Youth Gathering, which will be in Detroit. As you see, the cover of your bulletin this morning is from the Youth Gathering Rise Up Together, and it is in Detroit, and we're happy to have you here this morning. In fact, I'd like to ask if you would all stand up and kind of turn around. I think we'll call you the Zion Orange Crush or something like that. there are a few more who aren't here this morning also. We're listed in the bulletin, and we're kind of giving them a send-off this morning with our blessings, and we've already, as a congregation, provided regular funds for them, and we're thankful to each of you for your participation in helping them to go with that and to do that. Just a reminder for myself and my wife, Dawn, is here in 1976, which was a few years before both of you. 1976, Dawn and I was a pastor, a youth pastor at Trinity Lutheran Church in Eau Claire, fairly large congregation there. We took 37 of our young people from Trinity, filled up a bus, and went down to the National Lutheran Gathering in New Orleans. And that was quite an adventure, and we had a great inspiration, both in traveling together at the convention and then our coming home also. So that was a great experience for that particular time. Paul, have you been down to that convention?
I don't remember.
You don't remember? Paul Lustre. I should have known there'd be a good line. That's good. Well, we're going to hear from the group a little bit later, and we appreciate that, as I said, for you to be here. It's interesting to me. I was here last Sunday because Pat Keith was gone, and we had a nice group of people here, but there's a lot more people here this morning. So you get, you know, youth involvement and many of all kinds of people who come. That's a really good thing. It reminded me of the story of the time that the bishop came to speak in the congregation, and he came on Sunday morning and spoke at two services, and after the service, because he and the pastor were taking their robes off, the sacristy, the bishop kind of was saying, well, there was a pretty good group of people here today, but I'm the bishop, you know, kind of representing the church, and I kind of thought there would be more people here to hear the bishop. And he said, did you advertise that I was coming? And the pastor said, no, we didn't, but the word must have got out anyway. Your bulletin, and as I mentioned with the youth group there, and we thank the adults who are going along and helping out with that, and you who have helped to contribute. Following service today, as we most often do, we have fellowship coffee in fellowship hall, and we invite you to come join us for that and to share this special time. Just a note here that Zion serves the community supper at the Assembly in Baldwin. That's where the central point is. The different churches participate in sharing that supper. It's open for anyone who would like to come. We certainly invite all of you to be participants in that, but also we'd like to, you know, make sure that people who maybe don't have a good meal during the week, that they would be invited to come. So if you know somebody who could use a good meal that maybe doesn't have the funds for that, please invite them to come. That will be for Zion on Tuesday, August 4th. And Zion will be right out here, and a beautiful thing that kind of helping to see what we do and encouraging you to sign up to be people who participate in helping that meal to happen. So if you can do that, it's a great opportunity. And then just one little note here, in your bulletin is congratulations to Ken and Robin Lehman. Robin was a member of our congregation. I just like to kind of say that, you know, when people grow up somewhere and they go off in life, and then she was a gun ho, and they go to different places. Well, Robin came to Amory, and she and husband Ben are members of our congregation there. In fact, Robin was on our third council, so thank you for bringing her up to the church and helping her to go into the future and be a participant. As it says in the bulletin there, they had a new child, Kayla Ruth, who was born on July 1st. So just a thought about that. Any other announcements that you'd be making this morning? Okay, you'll find in your bulletin or your book, page 94, for our opening for the confession and forgiveness. We'll take the right hand column on page 94. The numbers at the bottom of the page in the front of the worship book. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who forgives all our sins and whose mercy endures forever.
Amen.
Almighty God, whom all hearts are open, all desires known and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let us confess our sins in the presence of God and of one another. Let's take a moment for silent reflection.
Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves into the power of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. We join together in the gathering hymn, Lift High the Cross, number 660. Lift high the cross. Will you please stand as we share together?
Thank you.
In your bulletin, we share together our confession of faith, theme Rise Up Together, and together we confess our faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We join together the prayer of the day. O God, from you come all holy desires, all good counsels, and all just works. Give to us, your servants, that peace which the world cannot give, that our hearts may be set to obey your commandments, and also that we, being defended from the fear of our enemies, may live in peace and quietness through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Thank you.
The first lesson is from Ephesians, chapter 1, verse 3 through 14. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ, in accordance with his pleasure and will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us. With all wisdom and understanding, he made known to us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ to be put into effect when the times reach their fulfillment, to bring unity to all things in heaven and on earth under Christ. In him we were also chosen, having been predestined according to the plan of him who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will, in order that we, who were the first to put our hope in Christ, might be for the praise of his glory. And you also were included in Christ when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. When you believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession, to the praise of his glory. Here ends the first reading.
The second reading is from Psalms chapter 85, verse 8 through 13. I will listen to what God the Lord says. He promises peace to his people, his faithful servants, but let them not turn to folly. Surely his salvation is near those who fear him, that his glory may dwell in our land. Love and faithfulness meet together. Righteousness and peace kiss each other. Faithfulness springs forth from the earth, and righteousness looks down from heaven. The Lord will indeed give what is good, and our land will yield its harvest. Righteousness goes before him and prepares the way for his steps. Here ends the second reading.
I'm going to invite later the young people to come forward when the skit takes place. And if you want to sit up here, fine, so that you can be a little closer and just kind of observe that as our children's time this morning. So you can either remain there, or if you want to come up here a little closer, we'll do that a little bit later, okay? So Sharon will be sharing special music with us this morning.
pray for blessings. We pray for peace, comfort for family, protection while we sleep. We pray for healing, for prosperity. We pray for your mighty hand to ease our suffering. And all the while you hear each spoken deed, yet love us way too much to give us lesser things. 'Cause what if your blessings come through raindrops? What if your healing comes through tears? What if a thousand sleepless nights are what it takes to know you're near? What if trials of this life are your mercies in disguise? Doubt your love, as if every promise from your word is not enough. And all the while you hear each desperate plea, long that we'd have faith to believe. 'Cause what if your blessings come through?
Sharon, thank you very much for sharing with us this morning. Sharon is a good friend of ours from our Savior's in Amory, and we last heard her sing at our friend's father's funeral at Lister Lutheran which is just north of Nelson where you cross over the river. So thank you for being with us here again this morning. We appreciate that. Grace to you and peace from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior, Jesus, whom we call the risen Christ. A lot of years ago, 1961, I came out of high school to go to Camp Knutson, north of Brainerd, Minnesota, to work there for the summer on the waterfront. And Camp Knutson was a beautiful spot on large Whitefish Lake. It had a dining hall that overlooked Whitefish Lake, a beautiful vista there. And on the other side, on the peninsula, it went down to where I spent most of my day on the waterfront on Trout Lake, and that was a beautiful, sandy, clear water beach. It was a beautiful spot, and I learned a lot that summer, sharing with young people who were staff, sharing with young people who came to the camp. The camp had been donated to the then American Lutheran Church by Congressman Knutson from Minnesota in the 50s, the end of the 50s, and it was designated as a camp for underprivileged or special needs children. And I thought, well, I was going there to give what I had to the students or the people who were there as campers, and I learned more, I'm sure, than they did from me. It was a great experience to be there in that camping experience. Gathering together like you are this morning is an experience of learning, experience of nurturing our faith and our commitment together with one another and with the church at large. Jim Sandham was the maintenance director at Camp Knutson in the summertime, and he was a wonderful guy, and I learned a lot of things from him. But there's an Old Testament text that we didn't read this morning from a description of Amos, the speaking prophet of the Old Testament, about 800 years before Jesus. And God asks Amos to set a plumb line in the midst of God's people. And Jim Sandham was a maintenance fellow who, for that summer, assumed the task of building a bell tower for the camp. And we had an old big bell that came out of a school, I believe, or a church. I can't remember quite which it was, but he had three huge telephone poles that he was trying to put together and put a frame on so that we could raise this bell tower. And he got campers involved and us involved, and he was trying to make sure that it was going to look good, that it would function well, it would stand up, and it would be straight. And so he was trying to do that, and he was teasing a little bit. He said, this is the way you look at making things straight. So he would say, you kind of go like this, and you go like this, and then it's straight. Well, okay. But then I found him one day, and I came up from the waterfront, and he had hung from the center of the bell tower of these three intersecting things going up, a plumb line. Now, some of you may know what a plumb line is, some of you may not, but it's a heavy weighted point that hangs on a line, and if you put it up at the top, it hangs straight, and you get the plumb, the up and down being straight up and down. You don't get the level with the plumb line, but you get the straight up and down. And so he was checking his calculations with the plumb line to make sure that it was okay. God's people, Amos said, have a plumb line in the presence of God in their midst. And that plumb line is important for us. For we who gather here this morning at Zion Congregation, some 2,800 years after Amos put that plumb line in, Our plumb line becomes our relationship, I believe, with Jesus, who is the risen Christ. And in the midst of us, who are God's people, he becomes the way in which we can understand our relationship to God and our relationship to one another in a true and good fashion. Your theme, Rise Up Together, is centered around the blessing of the Christ in our midst, who gives us a sense of who we are, and also, as you go together, in what we are as the people of God. I think it's really extremely important. In the psalm, which we read today, and thank you for reading that, there is a beginning part of that. It says, let me hear what God will speak. So the first way in which we kind of observe that plumb line, looking at it, is to hear what God has to say to us. We hear what God has to say as we read the scripture, as we have done this morning. We hear what God has to say to us as we gather together, as we have this morning, to do the liturgical parts of our service, to sing the hymns, to pray together, to hear what it is that God would share with us who are God's people. We also hear it in sermon like this, in devotions that we may share as we are together. When you go to the assembly, there will be times of prayer, there will be times of singing, there will be times of preaching, there will be times for you to listen, as there is times for us to listen. And God will speak. And what does God speak to us? It says in the psalm that God will speak peace to his people. God will speak peace to God's people. Sometimes we think about peace as being the absence of war, which would be wonderful. The absence of conflict, the absence of disruption or broken relationships, that would be peace. And that's good. But the Old Testament word for peace is shalom. And shalom is a bigger word than just the absence of war. It is the sense of well-being in all areas of our life, in our physical, in our spiritual, in our social, in our economic, in our gathering together as the people of God. Shalom is God's well-being and blessing into that experience. So I want you to listen. But I also want you to be involved in how it is that you share that peace of God with all people. What is it that we have to share? I think that's a good question. When you go, when you are here, what is it that we have? The psalmist says we have steadfast love from God and we have righteousness. God's love is never failing. God's love will always be with you, wherever you are and whoever you are. From the scripture, from the fellowship we share, from the preaching we have, God's love is something that you will never leave behind. We may go away from God, but God will be there with God's love. The second thing the psalmist talks about is righteousness. Big word from the Old Testament particularly. Basically, it simply means being in right relationship with God. Sometimes our lives are really, really good. And we want to say, thank you, God. And we are in right relationship when we give thanks to God. Sometimes our lives are kind of ordinary and things just kind of go from day to day. And we say, thank you, God, for being in our life as we go along. Sometimes our lives are complicated. Sometimes they're broken. Sometimes they're out of joint. And maybe we don't feel that we're in a right relationship with God. Maybe we don't feel we're in right relationship with one another. Yet God comes to us with righteousness. That is, God's steadfast love and forgiveness make us right in our relationship with God. And out of that relationship with God, out of that plumb line of God's love in our midst, we are able to forgive ourselves. We are able to forgive one another. And we are able to move forward in God's righteousness in our lives. In the lesson which you read from Ephesians, it says God has blessed us, the people of God, with every spiritual blessing. I like to say the gifts that you have as an individual are your spiritual blessing. Whatever it is that you like to do, that you are good at, that you are involved with, that is a blessing that you can share with other people. And I think you're going to be speaking at the gathering about seeing the needs of other people, about being involved in seeing what they might need that you can share because God has blessed you. You may be a blessing to them. And together, we are God's people, but not apart. We are God's people where we are, at school, at home, at work, in our community, on the playground, wherever that might be. We bring God's blessing into that place. So as we gather here this morning, and we prepare to send you on an interesting, hopefully, and meaningful experience, we hear the gospel, the good news of God's steadfast love hanging straight in the midst of our lives and of our communities. We hear the gospel, and we believe. We say, I believe in God the Father Almighty. I believe in Jesus Christ. I believe in the Holy Spirit. And those beliefs lead us in our daily life experience. And then we also understand that we are marked by the presence of God in our lives. For most of us, that's the sacrament of holy baptism, where we begin together as the people of God, in being blessed by God's presence in baptism, marked as the cross upon our forehead with the gift of the Holy Spirit. And we pray that that Holy Spirit that you are marked with will go with you in your trip. Have a wonderful experience with many, many thousands of other young people who are also marked with the Spirit as we are here in this congregation. And the end of it all is hopefully that we are able to share that steadfast love of God, the gifts which we share individually in being marked by God's love. We give those away to other people as we understand that they too, like we do, have needs, and we may help to meet those needs of those people. Thank you for observing the plumb line, if you will, as you build your life, if you want to, as we built that bell tower at Camp Knutson. I have a special memory of that bell tower 5 years after it was built. And in the meantime, I had met my wife, Joan, at college. And in 1966, we were married, and I was the director of the camp. Knutson at that time. Lake Park Wild Rice Children's Home from Fergus Falls, Minnesota was the camp in session at that point, and they had about 50 young campers of all different makes and denominations, I might say, as young people. Joan and I came back after being married on the weekend, and we had to get back to work, so we came Monday morning to Camp Knutson. They were all out ringing the bell to welcome us back to Camp Knutson. just one little thing there. Some of the girls were a little upset that I had married Joan because that took me out of... okay. I just had to say that because, you know, it kind of makes me feel good, but I was out of commission after that, on a good path. But the plumb line of that bell tower, the plumb line of our lives, the plumb line of God's love, we share in the needs of God's people. Amen. The hymn is number 705, God of Grace, number 705. This time we'll receive our offering, followed with prayer, and then we'll be sharing with the young people.
Thank you. Thank you.
Almighty God, our Creator and our Redeemer, a reconciler, we thank you for the gifts that you have given to us. And as we receive these gifts which we share together, we pray that the blessings which we have received we may use as a blessing to those who are around us, and that we may share your love and good news to all. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay. If there are any of the young people, excuse me, as you're getting ready there, if there are any of the young people who want to come up closer here during this, you're welcome to do that and sit right here in the pew or to remain in your places. But you're welcome to come down and join us here if you'd like to. We'll wait just a moment till see if there's anybody coming down. I think there may be some that were coming down from the balcony.
We're just going to set up our stage, so it'll be just a second. The skit, there's some people that kind of know it and some people that don't really, so we're just going to play it by ear, which we can do very well. We're really excited about this National Youth Gathering. It's been a lot of work. A lot of parents involved, right, a lot there. Of kids involved. Okay. We've been fundraising, and you have been giving very generously, and we just want to say thank you. We couldn't do this without you, not at all. Parents that have helped, grandparents, relatives, everything. This experience that these kids are going to be in is going to be so amazing. I went on a National Youth Gathering in 1989. Down to San Antonio, and we visited the Alamo, but it's nothing like this. We did not get to serve the community. We were together with, 30 to 40,000 other kids singing and being a part of one another, but this is a whole different experience. So I'm excited when they come back, which we will have a performance or a thank you when we do come back to share their experiences. So I'm really looking forward to them sharing what they seen, what they did. And so give us just a moment. We'll get this prepared for you. And once again, thank you, everyone that's helped.
Can see, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah. Step out on a busy street. See a girl and our eyes meet. Does her best to smile at me to hide what's underneath. There's a man just to her right. Black suit and a bright red tie. Too ashamed to tell his wife he's out of work. He's buying time. All those people going somewhere. Why have I never cared? Give me your eyes for just 1 second. Give me your eyes so I can see everything that I keep missing. Give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, the ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones forgotten. Give me your eyes so I can see. Yeah. 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 I've been here a million times, a couple million eyes. Just moving past me by, I swear I never thought that I was wrong. Well, I want a second glance, so give me a second chance to see the way you see the people all along. Give me your eyes for just 1 second. Give me your eyes so I can see everything that I keep missing. Give me your love for humanity. Give me your arms for the brokenhearted, the ones that are far beyond my reach. Give me your heart for the ones forgotten. Give me your eyes so I can see. Give me your eyes, Lord, give me your eyes so I can see everything that I keep missing, that I keep missing. Give me your heart for the broken heart. Give me your heart, Lord, give me your eyes. Yeah. 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 Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay. So what that was about, I don't know how much you said, but through the song, Give Me Your Eyes, what's essentially saying is we need to see the world around us, and day-to-day basis we don't. We live in a small town, Woodville. We don't see much. We're going to Detroit, which is really scary for me, especially me. I've heard a lot of bad things about Detroit and a lot of stereotypes, and I don't really know what I'm going to see. I don't really know what we're going to do. I know we're going to help people rise up, right? Through the skit, I came out a little bit after he had gone through. He's asking to see what's going on around him. You can take this skit scene almost as Detroit. There are homeless. There are people who have made mistakes being teen pregnancy. There are people without jobs. Unemployment is a huge problem, as well as hunger. Thank you. Couldn't remember that. There are all these different problems, and he's asking him to give me your eyes. I want to see these different things. And through that, when I kind of motioned, I kind of showed him what went on through the poor, through the hungry. And I kind of told him, you can help, you can rise up, you can make a difference. And that was the gist of it.
I went to New Orleans, and on the last day, we were walking out of the Superdome, which is where the Saints play, and I texted my parents that I was going to Detroit 3 years later, so I knew right away that I loved it. And so in New Orleans, we painted a church. There were over 30,000 kids our age there for this trip. And ever since then, my mom's been asking, are you still going? Are you still going? And it's, yes, Mom, I'm still going to enjoy it. There was really no question. It was one of the best weeks of my life there. So there wasn't really any specific thing that like jumped out at me. It was just everything about it was great. And so we're going to Detroit, and you might think the worst part about it is that we're going to be at Detroit, but I think the worst part is that the bus ride's half the length that it was in New Orleans, and we made a lot of memories on that bus ride, so half the memories, half the bus ride. So if it's half as fun as New Orleans was, it's going to be a great week.
When you're done, I'll have you stay right there, if you will. Are you wanting to say something? Okay. thank you for kind of giving us a sense of your going, and we appreciate that you're going to be traveling in good company, and I hope that you will be helpful to one another as you go on that journey. And I know, as you mentioned, the relationships of the journey are very important, and the relationships of the people who will be there with you in Detroit are very important. So we look forward to that. I want to share a prayer and then to have the blessing before we sing the final hymn. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, Lord, we give you thanks for this day of life that you have given to each one of us. We thank you for the blessings that you have given to us as your people. Today, we particularly give thanks for these young people who are able to go and share in an experience of growth and development in their spirit and faith, in opening their eyes and our eyes to the world around. We pray that your Spirit will lead and guide those who are adults who are attending, those who are young people who are attending, those who are families who are here at home and are thinking about and wondering what is taking place there, for our whole community, that we may be blessed as you have been blessed by this particular experience. Lord, set your plumb line of love, steadfast love, forgiveness, and hope in our midst as we send these young people to this experience with the National Evangelical Lutheran Church in America Youth Gathering. Let us join together as we pray the prayer which Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Before I give you the blessing, I'd just like to say thank you again for sharing this morning and for your thoughts. I'd like to ask if you would come out with me during the final verse of the hymn and just kind of line up in back, and people can give you their personal blessing as you are going, okay? The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Let us together say amen.
Amen.
Final hymn, let us join together, Rise Up, O Saints of God.